together. Wonder as we say the name of Jesus. Anybody know the word? Say the name of Jesus. Say the name. Genesis, the third chapter, starting at verse 6. Genesis, the third chapter, starting at verse 6. When you find it, say amen.
Amen.
Please stand to your feet as we give reverence to the reading of the word of God. Genesis, the third chapter, starting at verse 6. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat it, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. The eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves apron. They heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord amongst the trees of the garden. The Lord called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, Who told thee that thou wast naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldst not eat? And the man said, The woman who thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. The Lord God said unto the woman, What is this thou hast done? And the woman said, The serpent beguiled me, and I did eat. And the word of the Lord is blessed. As you remain standing, we come to preach to you from the subject, Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Let us pray. Eternal God, we thank you for your mercy and your grace. God, now we stand in this awesome responsibility called preaching. God, we come standing believing that you've given us the word to spew out to your people. God, I ask that you would stand up and sit me down, hide behind your cross. Allow the people to see and hear you as your book talks to them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated in his presence. There's a man by the name of Paul Machiavelli. He's famous. The famous actor comes from North Haven, Connecticut, graduated from Cleveland High School. Machiavelli received his master's degree in English from Fairfield University back in 1992 as a member of the theater group. He became one of the most recognizable actors on television for nearly 20 years as an actor. He doesn't have an Emmy, he doesn't have an Oscar, but he's famous. His voice and his face remains one of the most famous faces and voices that you would hear. And basically because of his ability to be connected to people. From 2001 to 2014, he appeared in hundreds of commercials for Verizon Wireless. And in 2002, Machiavelli started appearing as the test man for Verizon Wireless, for which Entertainment Weekly named him one of the most intriguing people in 2. And he was identified as the "Can you hear me now" guy. His character was a clever advertisement piece that reminded people that Verizon was the most powerful cell phone company in the country because regardless of where you were, you could be connected to another voice. In fact, you could be connected to the voice of your choice. I remember back in Hurricane Katrina and when the cell towers were being affected by the water and the wind and then knocked down and everybody was using their cell phone, I was happy to be a Verizon customer. Because when I called somebody and I said, "Can you hear me now?" they would answer yes. He became so popular that he took that as a career move that blessed him better than many other actors would be blessed. And it stuck so long that in 2016, when all the cell towers seemed to be able to get all the reception, he switched over to Sprint. And still was known as the "Can you hear me now" for Verizon, but now he's with Sprint. It just reminded me of how important connection is. And we've learned that with our own technology, because when you can't get a good connection, you can't talk to anybody. Yesterday we had a workshop on domestic violence and abuse, and the stories from the victims of domestic abuse and violence were powerful testimonies about how they had survived. The overall message was that you can survive even avoid violence and abuse once you get a good connection with God. So as I closed yesterday in prayer, I challenged them to come hear me today because I was already ready to have my text and ready to go. And I told them I'm going to be preaching from, "Can you hear me now?" Or remember, your mama called you and you didn't answer real quick and, "Can you hear me?" Sometimes we wanted to hear them and sometimes we didn't want to hear them. But the whole idea, "Can you hear me now," means that you're making a connection. Today, our God Not Done Sunday, this day has been set aside on our calendar to declare that we will choose God over guns and violence. Do I have anybody here who is ready to choose God over guns and violence? When approving yesterday's program, I didn't realize the connection between the both domestic abuse, the domestic abuse program I've got on guns service today. I was reminded as I looked at the standard coming from the Brady Center that our God Not Done service, a worship service experience, has been in place since 2008. So we're not just doing this because we heard about Black Lives Matter. We're not just doing this because we saw what has happened over the past couple of years now with police brutality in our community and outside our community to African Americans. We're doing this because we've been believing for a long time. If you have God on your side, you don't have to resort to guns and violence. It was brought to my attention by a member, and I immediately picked up on it and embraced the idea we've been doing since. The Brady Center and other faith communities around the nation are challenged to reflect and respond to this epidemic of gun violence that kills nearly 30,000 Americans every year. 30,000 Americans every year. And it's not just people who actually go out and shoot people, as people who accidental murders. We had just not recently, about a year or so ago, a young lady in the East London community whose 4-year-old shot the 5-year-old because there was a gun in the house. And many of us have had guns in the house. It's a matter of protection of guns in the house. Like we had old guns. Some of what they call added guns, they just have, the gun turning movement where Great Abyssinia Baptist Church and a church in Trenton where people brought guns and, I was there turning in some guns that was in the attic and things of that nature. Yeah, I had guns in the attic, but I had to get rid of them. And then come to realize that there were so many people that didn't look like us that had a whole school. I'm talking about they got 5,000 guns in one day. And I think the tally was even more than that later on. But what it was saying was that we have embraced this thing called a gun more than we have really embraced God. Because with God on your side, now I know some of y'all from the South like my father, with God on your side, you believe God had a gun. But live long enough to see what the gun will do. You know, I talk to some people, and got a couple of friends that we're talking, brag about, well, yeah, I got a gun, I'm not gonna use it, I'm just gonna scare somebody. If you got a gun and you don't use it, you're already a fool. Because if you got a gun, you're gonna have to use it, so it don't make sense to have the gun, so you won't use the gun. I don't know nobody who has a gun and ready to have it and not use it, because if you got a gun and you don't use it, you're gonna get killed yourself. We have to understand the problem exists beyond the gun. The problem exists because we don't understand the protection that we need to have for ourselves, and that protection is spiritual. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God. We are not fighting against flesh and blood, but against principalities and spiritual wickedness in high places. And that's bigger than a gun. And listen, you're talking to somebody who understands, who's seen guns his whole life, who have been in places where guns have been shot, and who have been in places who to see people get shot, someone who has lost his own brother because of guns, the number 90-something murder in the city of Newark just 3 years ago because of guns. So you have to understand that we're just not talking about this just because it's something good to talk about, but it's a reality. And we have to understand that through worship, through prayer, through music, through art, that God Not Gun Sundays like this are asking people of faith to stand strong and say, I'm going to trust God more than the guns in my life. If we listen closely through the noise of the violence that lingers around, if we listen closely to some of the stories we heard yesterday, that the women being abused and men having been abused, or somewhere there was a gun involved and somewhere there wasn't, but at the end of the day, it's violence. And when you look at violence, it's always related to sin. And sin results into what? Death. In the text, the woman stared at the forbidden fruit, even though God said to Adam, you will die if you partake in it. It looked beautiful and tasty. She wanted the wisdom that it would give her, and she ate some of the fruit. Her husband was there with her, so he ate some of the fruit that she gave him, and he didn't just take what she gave him. He wanted to blame her. He probably, and I'm sure he did, took some of the fruit too because they said it was good. And we have to understand that, especially when we look at this story, because sin is developing out of something that is good. Ain't nobody in here who's ever struggled with sin, and those of us who are struggling with sin right now are not in the midst of that because it's bad. You know, the old folks used to say, you know, I'm glad I got away from that miserable life of sin. It wasn't miserable. It wasn't. And that's some of you laughing and some of you not, some of you trying to keep it in. It wasn't miserable. Because if it was miserable, you would have never been in it. The bottom line is that at the end of the day, it wasn't good for it. Oh, let me help you out. You know, I'll go to my own, you know, I'm type 2 diabetic. And chocolate chip cookies are at the top of the list. If I eat a box of chocolate chip cookies, it ain't miserable. Give me some milk, nice cold milk, and some chocolate chip cookies. I'm going to feel real good. But eventually, it's not going to be good for me when my blood sugar levels get to the point where I'm having a diabetic coma. And that's what we need to look at, because we are so caught up in our feel good and the things that we're going through, we don't look at those things. Adam and Eve didn't realize what they had done, and they realized they were naked. They were sewing fig leaves together to make something to cover themselves, which means they were trying to cover up their sin. You know, it's like, you know, who stole the cookie out of the cookie jar? Nobody wants to claim it. You know, you want to make sure there's still a few that people won't see that you're within. Later they heard the Lord God walking in the garden, and they were frightened, and they hid behind these leaves and some trees. And the Lord called out to Adam and asked, where are you? He answered, in a pure embarrassment, things. The woman. Now watch this. He blamed the woman that God gave him as a blessing. Well, if you go back and read the story, he said he already had told him that he shouldn't be alone. And so that's why he gave him the woman. And if you read the story clearly, in this instance, the woman doesn't have a name. So that means that she wasn't just next to him. She was just, they were part of each other. And the whole separation of the man and woman come because of this mere act that is done. So he goes to the woman and he said, "What have you done?" And she immediately makes an excuse and says, "The snake tricked me." She had the Flip Wilson mentality. Y'all know what I'm going with this? The devil made me do it. And we have the tendency to do that. Adam and his wife disconnected themselves from God because of sin and because of greed. And we have a tendency to still do that today, to disconnect ourselves from God because of sin and because of greed, because of our own personal inhibitions and what we want to do. And I come to tell you, this text teaches us three things, and I'm going to be done, and you'll be on your way. It teaches us, in the midst of a sinful world, that everything that looks good is not good for you. It teaches us that we need to seek God before he starts seeking us. And finally, we need to listen when God is calling. A lot of times we don't hear God calling us because some of us talk too much. And 9 times out of 10, we're talking about ourselves. We're not talking about nothing important. We just want people to know about us. And when we're not talking about us and it's not about us, then we don't want to connect with nobody. Violence is a behavior that involves physical force intended to hurt, damage, or kill someone or something. I don't subject to violence for anything because I believe that we need to be able to stand, and if we're able to stand strong, we don't have to be violent in the process. God can't prove that to us. In an instance, he stood for nonviolence, but it was violence that ended up killing him. Some people think that we need to have a certain level of violent behavior to protect ourselves, so we yell, we threaten to prove we are strong and that we are important, not realizing that our violent behavior only exposes our weakness. And you can be violent, I learned this yesterday, without even touching somebody. You can be violent with your mouth. Oh, I'm talking to somebody, I know it's a lot of women in here, but I heard that women can be real violent with their mouth. Just give them an opportunity to say what they need to say. They can cut you every which way, but lose them, not put their hands on. Words are powerful. And that's why we got to be understanding of what we say and what we do. You saw me just discipline my grandson. I tell him, "No, you know better. Get back over here. You know what you need to do. If you have to go, go around the altar." He's been here enough. He knows how to do that. But we got to teach them. Now, what if I was, "Boy, what you doing?" and yelling at him and calling all kinds of things. How is he going to grow up? He's going to grow up with that same mentality. We got to teach our young people what is right and teach them what is wrong and help them to understand along the way and stop being hypocrites because we're getting upset and beating them because of stuff that we did, and we're not really beating them. We're beating ourselves up because we never learned any better. So we talk to them any kind of way. We act any kind of way. We give them any kind of disposition. And then we got the nerve to look at them and say, "I don't know what's wrong with them." You what's wrong with them? They are carbon copies of who we are. If we pour something good into them, then something good is going to come out of them. If all we're going to do is beat stuff into them, guess what they're going to do? They're going to either beat it into somebody else, or when they get older, they want to beat us back. Now that's why you got your gun, because now you want to shoot them because you can't beat them no more. It doesn't make sense. There has to be something behind it. It looks good to be tough and considered tough, but I learned something growing up in the hood. I didn't grow up around here like some people may have been privileged to be, but I learned something, that tough guys don't live long. But
people to see what adults do. It looks good, Marcus, to see me with my car and then see me getting a pension and see me working all those years. It look good to see me and your mother walking around holding our hands. It look good for people to see how adults get together and be whatever. But there's a reason for having to grow up and become an adult, because you got to be responsible with the things that you do. That's why it's an age 18 and at age 21, because we found out living in this world that you can't handle everything that we do. That's why you got to wait for the right opportune time, because God is saying that if you participate in some stuff that you shouldn't be participating in, and it's called sin, you can literally die. I understand, I'm for real. Our young people need to understand that there was time when we just worried about getting a sexually transmitted disease, but now and you can die because you don't know what somebody else had. And so we got to talk to them. And we, you know, you can tell them to come to the altar and pray all you want, but you got to start talking to them about protecting themselves and understanding and having an education around what they're doing. Because it gets crazy out there. And when you do that, that means you're seeking God for some advice. And we don't normally seek God for advice. So second thing I need you to understand is seek God before he seeks you. We have the tendency to walk away from God when life gets good to us. Don't let us graduate college. Don't let us get a degree behind our name. God forbid we get a good job or we become an entrepreneur and make some money. And if we really become some kind of professional entertainer or star and get a whole lot of money, there is no God around, because we think and the worst thing about that, some of us are broke. And because we can go to the club and have a good time, we think it's all about us. Give us a little cable, give us a nice cell phone, give us some good reception, and allow us to be able to be online. We think it's all about us and we forget about God. And as I said the week before, instead of us believing God for everything that we do, when something goes wrong, what do we start doing? We start begging God. And I come to tell you, and I'm talking to you as a body of Christ, even as church folk. Like I said, that's the last thing you want to hear me say about money. I'm not going to beg nobody for nothing. I'm not going to beg nobody for nothing, because the God that I serve said that he will supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory. All I got to do is get out there and evangelize. All I got to do is make sure that I'm doing everything that I'm doing for the glory of God. All I got to do is get on my knees. Because the prayers of the righteous availeth much. And then some folk, if you don't do it that way, want you to be held hostage by what they do. When we can buy what we want and do what we want, then there is no connection with God. We should be thanking God every time we turn the key in our door. We should be thanking God before we even get in the car to thank God for the car. We should thank God for the bus card, even if we're riding the bus. We should thank God if we're not riding the bus, that we got somebody who can pick us up. We should thank God just the mere fact that he is God. Do I have any witnesses here? Are you thanking him for the witness? Because if you don't, it will turn into sin, and it will make you think that you're in control. And the devil will say, you don't have to go to church. You don't have to worship God. You don't have to pay no money. You don't have to give no tithes. You don't need to do that. God said, you don't think nothing's going to happen to you. It's not going to go wrong. And he said the same thing to Adam and Eve. And then they found themselves exposed, because sin will eventually expose you if you don't repent and ask God forgiveness. Gun violence and domestic violence has no place in a decent, functional society. We need to cast it out and believe that it shouldn't be there. Don't wait until you get into that situation. You should believe God right now and say, God, I know I trust you, and I want to protect my family, but God, if you give me the strength, you will make me wise enough to be able to protect my family and call upon the people who have the weapons of warfare to protect us in the process. I come to tell you that this dysfunctional behavior, it shows its face most of the time when you're hurt or in pain. And when that hurt and pain exists in somebody's life, every one of us in here have the capacity to commit a violent act. I don't care how nice you are. I don't care how docile you are. If you The devil can bring something into your life and make you want to commit violence right then and there. You don't believe me? Let somebody mess with your child. You don't believe me? Let somebody cross you. I don't care how safe you are. The whole idea of I got to get them will come across your mind. Don't you dare think that this stuff is happening to people just because nobody wakes up and says, I'm going to kill somebody today unless they're deranged. Nobody wakes up and say, I want to be violent against the person who I love unless something is wrong with them. Nobody wakes up and say, I want to commit a violent act today. But what the devil does, he wakes up and says, let me see how I can stir up something today. Let me see if I can abuse somebody's child. Let me see if I can touch somebody's nerve the wrong way. Let me see if I can get up under somebody's skin. And then guess what? That's when the sin begins to creep up. And if you don't have the power of God on your side, if you are not in church, and if you are not seeking Him and worshiping Him, guess what? You become a victim of your own circumstance. Finally, we all need to listen when God is calling. God is trying to call all of us out of darkness into light. That's why we come to church. And that's what we're supposed to be doing when we leave here. We're supposed to be showing people the light. That's what we're supposed to be doing when we go out and we talk to people. When they called me to go to the rally, I didn't know I was going to meet John Black, but I did know that I was being called out so I can tell somebody that there is a light at the end of the tunnel. I can tell them in the mixed crowd that there is some hope along the way. I can tell them that if we come together, we don't have to fall together. We can be strengthened. I can tell them about who God has been to me and how good God has been to me. I didn't have to quote one scripture. I didn't have to tell nobody about Revelations and then backpedal all the way to Genesis. All I had to do was be a beacon of light, because when I got down, people wanted to know where the church was. People wanted to know who did I represent. People wanted to know how did you were able to come out and be able to talk this way, because it was about the way I live, not about what I was saying. Because if you live for God, He will show people that He's a way maker. If we're not careful and we don't listen to our children, and we don't listen to our children and what they're saying, then our children's children will suffer. And sometimes I get so passionate about what I'm saying and I'm doing that I get overexcited and I preach so hard. But I learned that if I preach real hard and fell out, I still wouldn't make a difference to a bunch of people. My father told me a couple weeks ago, no, just last week, he said, don't preach so hard, son. I need you here. But there's something about the goodness of Jesus that just gets me riled up. I would love to give you a nice girl, Austin. I would just love to stand here and say, out the door with you. when a gun goes off, that was supposed to be for protection, but it kills somebody in the house. Oh, I understand that too. I'll tell you that story later. Well, my daughter shouldn't be living right now when a gun went off and the bullet went right in the wall and she happened to have been in the refrigerator. I come to tell you,
Korea, yes.
just a week or so ago for a peace conference. And in the midst of them going there to the peace conference, we would have a president of our country mock a world leader, call it Rocket Man, talk about it. And I don't care who he is, but what he doesn't understand is that even in South Korea, the ally, it's only 30-something miles away from North Korea. And like I said, if God can't, and if the devil can't get to you, he's going to get the next thing closest to you. So if I talk about wiping you out, what do you think somebody else is going to do? They're going to wipe out somebody close to us. We need to understand the power of what's going on now. And our young people need to understand that life is not just this big ball of fun or flavor, but life is to be lived with value and responsibility. The old folk used to say, hush, hush, somebody's calling my name. Y'all remember that? Somebody's calling your name. And they're saying, it's me. It's the Lord calling you to come closer to me. We offer you an opportunity right now to make a difference. Can you hear the Lord calling you? He wants you to be part of a body that says, I believe in God. I believe God is my strength. I believe God will help me change and make an impact on the lives of the people that I love.
We fail to take him up on that opportunity. The doors of the church have been open for 2,000 years and they stay open. I'm not looking for members. I'm looking for disciples who declare that you want to tell somebody about the goodness of God. Don't tell nobody about whether you like me preaching or didn't like me preaching. You need to leave here telling somebody about the goodness of God. And he's asking them, can you hear my voice through everything that's going on? If there's somebody who has a particular issue that they're going through right now, be it if be personal, be it if be physical, we invite you to come to the altar during this God Not Done Sunday. We want to pray for those who may have been dealing with difficulties in the household, or difficulties in their body. Maybe you've dealt with some domestic violence in the past, and you're trying to get beyond the feelings that you had in the midst of that. We ask that you would come up today so that we can help you get the strength that you need. You need to leave here empowered that God will continue to strengthen your heart. Is there one who want to come? You just might need a personal prayer to strengthen you along the way. We invite you to come. We invite you to come. And if you're standing where you are, you're okay. You're okay. So see, the devil wants you to say, yeah, don't go up there, or yeah, you don't have to go up there. Well, he wants to make you fearful. The God that I serve, he will meet you right there, right where you're standing, right where you're sitting. Let us pray. Eternal God, as we sing this song, and we say somebody's calling your name, God, help them to know that it's you. You're calling for them in these last legal days. You're calling for greater evangelism. You're calling for greater discipleship. You're calling for greater belief. God, we ask that you would continue to remind them to start believing in you and stop begging you for stuff. If they would just believe that they are prosperous and believe that they have the job and believe that they're healthy and believe that they're going to get through this diagnosis, then they will see your glory, because miracles, we know, are designed so that the glory of God can be seen. Oh God, so we pray for those who are dared to come today. God, we don't know what their situation is, and we don't know what they're going through. But God, we come together, not just me, but collectively. I believe everybody is praying for those who are in need. Oh God, those who have come forth and those who are still in their seat. God, we ask that your blessings will continue to reign in their life. God, let them lift you up. Let them know that no weapon formed against them will prosper as long as they love you. God, the weapon can't prosper because you are the weapon maker. Oh God, you're the one who creates everything, and nothing is made without you. And we know that what you make for good, that the devil tries to turn to evil. You put relationships together for good, and the devil tries to make it bad. You put friendships together for good, and the devil tries to make it bad. You build churches to bring people together for the good, and the devil tries to make it bad. But God, we want to say, we're not begging you to do what we know you can already do. We are believing you right now in the name of Jesus. We're believing you for our healing. We're believing you by faith. We're believing you that you want to turn somebody's financial situation around. God, we're believing you that every family member here will have a healthy relationship in their family, that mothers will get along with daughters and daughters will get along with mothers and sons will get along with fathers and then fathers will get along with sons. God, we ask that you would step in right now and meet the brokenness of the young people who stand here still looking for that love from their parents, looking for a father who's not in the household, looking for a mother who hasn't raised them. Oh God, we ask that you would peer into their lives, give them strength. And God, most of all, we pray that the young people will embrace and love the people who are in their lives. God, let them not take it for granted. Let them know that grandma's love and grandpa's love and mommy's love and daddy's love is not just by chance, but it's because of the love of Jesus that has been placed in their heart. And God, we ask that you will look over our community, look over our country, Lord, for we are in dire straits. God, we know that you're talking. We just want to hear closely what you're saying. So as you speak to us, Lord,
speak to us, we're going to glorify you. As you speak to us, we're going to lift up your name. Oh God, we know that as long as we give you the glory, that you will make a way out of no way. Yes, we pray for the White House because we don't have nothing else to do. We have nothing else left but God. So we pray that you will show up and that you will put it in order, that you will make sure your people are taken care of. Because you said, if my people who are called by thy name will humble themselves and turn from their wicked ways, then I will heal their land. God, we believe it and we count it done. And we claim victory in the name of Jesus. We love you, Lord. And we bless your holy name. As you lift your hands with me, God, we leave here with benediction power. Now unto him who's able to keep us from falling, to the all-wise God, his power and his dominion. God, continue to grant us the peace that passes all understanding, because we will never understand your ways. But as long as it directs us to be closer and closer to Christ Jesus, we will claim victory in your name, and we will give you glory, give you honor,